Good morning and welcome. Come on in and grab a seat. We're so glad that you're here with us today. If you're a guest, we welcome you. And if you're a guest, we'd love to know a little bit more about you. If you're willing to fill out one of the cards in the seat back pockets in front of you, drop it in the offering basket, that would help us to know a little bit more about who you are. And it's a way also you can ask questions of us if you want to know a little bit more about who we are. You saw lots going on the announcements. A couple of things just want to bring to you verbally and point out to you. You might have seen on your way in that there are hanging baskets for sale out there. That is with Mountain Vision. It's a ministry that we partner with. Mike and Jill Thompson head up that ministry, and we just want to bless them as much as we can. So if you're in need of a hanging basket, or you can think of somebody that you could bless with that, help support Mountain Vision and get a nice basket at the same time. Also, if you are 15 years old and a member of our church, today is church board elections, at least for half of our board. We stagger their terms, but if you have not voted, we ask that you please would out in the foyer today before you leave. And lastly, this Thursday night is one of our celebration services. We do that about every quarter, and it's just a time where we come together and we celebrate what God's doing in our lives, individually, corporately as well. It's just a wonderful night of celebration, so we invite you to come and be part of that. And that'll happen Thursday at 6:30. Well, we got a lot of good stuff going on today. We're honoring our graduates today, and we're just excited about this day. We're excited about what's already happened in first service, an incredible service, expecting good things second service as well. So take a moment, greet the people around you, and then we will begin to worship.
Thank you. All right, everybody out there, go ahead and stand up if you can.
We'll be right back.
singing glory, glory. Send your glory. Send your glory. Send your glory.
Lift up. Salvation in the name of Jesus. Freedom in the name of Jesus. Restoration in the name. There's power. Oh, the things that make your heart cry, to be the church that you would desire, a light to be seen. Break down our pride, and all the walls we built up inside, our earthly crowns and all our desires, lay at your feet. Let hope darkness tremble in your holy light. Every hour sing, Jesus, our God, great and mighty to be praised. God of all names,
great and mighty to be praised.
'Cause with everything, with everything, we will shout for your glory. With everything,
with everything, we will shout for your praise. With everything, with everything, we will shout for your glory. With everything, with everything, we will shout for your praise.
With everything we are, with everything we are,
we're standing in our deepest of hearts, in our own words, without a song telling us, let's just tell him how much we love him, how much we appreciate him, how grateful we are that the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the God of all creation, would meet with us. On a daily basis. Can you just express your love to him? In your own words, your own song. From deep places. So grateful. I've been overwhelmed to think this weekend of where I would be without you. I don't like that thought. I'm so grateful and thankful it's not reality. Thank you that you know me intimately, every part of me, my DNA, my makeup, what makes me tick. And you like it. I'm thankful that you have a plan for our life. God, we're thankful that you have a plan, that you know what lies ahead, and that you want to guide and lead and bless us, maybe more than we even realize. You want to talk to us. You want to be intimate with us. God, we thank you that we can freely in this country worship you together and express our thanks and appreciation to you. So God, we give you our lives again today. We give you our children. We give you our grandchildren. We give you our brothers and our sisters. We give you, Lord Jesus, those people who we love who may not be with you today. Most of all, we give you ourselves and our hearts. Would you intercede with me for those who are on the screen? Just call some out by name or other needs that you might know and bring them to the Father. Bring them to the throne. God, I thank you that you meet every need, that you are a good God. I thank you that they are not just words on a screen to you, but they are people, beloved people, people that you love so much, that you know intimately. I pray that your grace and mercy would be extended to each one by your Holy Spirit. I pray that you would help us as a body to come alongside and to show your love tangibly. God, I pray for Pastor this morning. He's not feeling well. You know what's attacking his body, and I come against it in the name of Jesus. I ask for healing physically. I ask for restoration emotionally, spiritually. God, I know there would be no better place he would rather be than right here, right now. And so I pray that he would feel the body, this congregation loving out to him today. Most of all, that he would feel you, Lord, and your healing today. So we're in love with you, Jesus. We're glad to be here this morning. We also bring our tithe and our offering, and we give it with grateful hearts. We just give back a piece of what you've given us. You've given us everything, God, so it's all yours. But we give, Lord God, our tithes and our offerings. May it be used, Lord, for your glory here in Wooster and around the world. May you multiply it, God. May it be used that people would come to know you and people would be set free. In Jesus' name, may we continue to be a lighthouse, God, in this community. We praise you, God. We love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray all these things. Amen. Thank you.
About what it means for us. Just a reminder, Pastor talked about the baby bottles last week for the Pregnancy Care Center. Those should be out in the foyer. Please make sure you grab one of those, fill it with, they'd prefer bills, you can put coins in there. The more the better to bless this ministry we believe in so much and support. So please make a point of grabbing one of those. Just a reminder that we're doing the board elections. There should be in the bulletin an insert with pictures and bios about those who are running. Please take that prayerfully, consider it. If you haven't voted yet today, please make sure you do that before you leave, okay? It's really important. We want to seek the Lord and have the Spirit-led leadership that He wants us to have so that we are moving forward in the things that He has for us. And then just a reminder that this Thursday is a celebration service. That's where we all come together. You're encouraged to sit with your Fusion group, but the main point is to be here together for worship, prayer, fellowship, sharing of testimonies about what God's doing. So please make that a priority to come out for that, okay? Put that on your calendar and make it a point to be here, all right? Well, at the end of service today, we're going to be honoring graduates, and what I'm going to talk to you about this morning really came out of thinking about that process today. We know the graduations happen at different points with the different schools, but today is the day that we are going to honor the graduates in our midst, and so what I want to share with you springs out of thinking about really what kind of world they're getting ready to walk out into, because the world they're walking into is not the same one that was there even 5 or 10 years ago. Let alone 30 or 40 or 50. And I think that's part of the problem that we face in the church right now. Latest statistics say that 40% of the people that you will encounter out there have no church background whatsoever. 40%. And that number has increased from 9% over just the last 25 or 30 years. So think about what that means for our culture. Increasingly, we are out there interacting with people who have no idea what that cross means. They see crosses all the time. They see them hanging from the necks of rappers and music videos and all that, but they don't get the significance. When you talk about church, when you talk about Jesus, when you talk about the Holy Spirit, they have no idea what you're talking about. No concept whatsoever. There's a label that's been put on this generation. People are calling them the postmoderns. Now, try to define that term as like trying to nail jello to the wall. Everybody's got a different understanding of what it means. But this is what we know about the postmodern generation. There are three characteristics that seem to be central to who they are. Number one is they believe there is no such thing as absolute truth. So whatever you say you believe, whatever you say is important to understanding this world and what goes on in this world, they say, that's fine for you. You go ahead and believe that if you want to. It's not what I believe and I don't have to. So they don't believe there's any absolute truth. So you can say to them, did you know there's a hell and you're going to be going there if you don't have Jesus? And they're going to go, oh, that's fine for you if you believe that. Why should I? Number two, they're not interested in sermons. They really don't want to be lectured. They don't want to hear us standing up and declaring this is what we know, this is what we believe. They're just not interested. But they're very interested in stories. They love stories. And connected to that point, number three is this. They are very much focused on and they very much value experience. Sounds like a tough culture, doesn't it? Do you know what I think about that? I think it is absolutely awesome. I do. You know why? Because the culture that we are placed in this day and time, is the most like the first century culture that Jesus was in since the first century. Because you see, along about 300 AD, something happened to us that really, in hindsight, probably wasn't very good for us. Constantine, the Roman emperor, who at least was smart enough to see what was going on, that despite his best efforts to persecute, despite everybody that had gone before him trying to persecute the church, it just kept growing. It just kept growing and growing and growing, and they couldn't stamp it out. So what Constantine did is he made Christianity the official religion of the Roman Empire. And man, everybody was celebrating. They came up with a term called Christendom, which meant this: the kingdom of our God and the kingdom of this world have now become one. Everybody was happy. Because now, man, the church is ruling the state. The church is taking things where it ought to be. We're going to see God's kingdom on earth. How well did that work out for us? It didn't. Because the kingdom of the world took control. And so you see, at a point where the corruption was so great, there were some very brave people that came to a new country and decided that they were going to found a new nation based on the truth of God's word, based on Jesus as Savior, based on God as Creator, based on the truth of the Bible. And that was really good, except then we went about creating a culture where everybody knew what we were talking about, and everybody worked from the same terminology, and everybody had the same understanding of God. And that worked okay for a while, kind of. But the problem is it started changing about 45 or 50 years ago, and we didn't realize it. We didn't get it. It started clear back in the 60s that people started going, absolute truth, what's absolute truth? The Bible, who wrote that? Jesus, who's that guy? What's he all about? How do you know he did what you say he did? And they started giving up their faith in what we claim to be true. And it took us a long time to figure it out. It took us a long time to figure it out. And so now we're faced with a situation where we can't rely on there being a base out there of understanding where we can just start up a conversation with people, hey, do you know Jesus? And they're going to know what we're talking about. And I think that's one of the best things that could have happened to us. Because you see, religion is kind of like getting an inoculation. You get this weakened form that's just enough that your body develops an immunity to it. So for a long time, we thought that we were doing great, and the whole time, we were losing our influence out there. But because we had a little dose, we had enough, we thought we were okay. And the whole time, we've been steadily losing our influence in the world. And we've been steadily being influenced by the world. Until that flame inside of us that's supposed to burn so brightly became a faint flicker. Do you know they say that if you had perfect atmospheric conditions, no pollutants, no haze, no anything like that in the atmosphere, that you could see a single candle burning from 30 miles away? Do you know why that is? Because light overcomes darkness. When you've got a light on in your house at night and you open up the curtains, does the darkness spill in? No, the light spills out. See, darkness is nothing more than the absence of light. But the problem is, the darkness has been creeping in because we grew dim. We grew dim. See, I look in Matthew 5, and I want you to know I'm preaching to me too, okay? This is one of those where I was like, I really don't want to get up and speak this because I'm going to have to deal with it myself. It's much easier when it's your problem. Matthew 5, 14 through 16. You are the light of the world, like a city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. No one lights a lamp and then puts it under a basket. Instead, a lamp is placed on a stand where it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your good deeds shine out for all to see, so that everyone will praise your Heavenly Father. These graduates are walking out into a world that at least 40% of the time doesn't even know who Jesus is. And there's probably a higher percentage that say, well, we may know who he is, but we don't care because we don't see the relevance to our lives. Matter of fact, when we hosted the district education conference a year ago, the speaker who came in, who's done a ton of research on the culture, He came in and said the number one reason that people in the 18 to 35 or 40 bracket weren't coming to church was they did not see church as being relevant to their lives anymore. Why? Is it because Jesus ceased to be relevant? The Holy Spirit ceased to be relevant? Or is it because they didn't see him being relevant in us? You see, the light that shines in the darkness is the light that flows out of us when we allow him to change us. If they've quit believing, it's because we quit living the light. We allowed the light to grow dim, and now they're looking at us and saying, well, why would I want what you have? You say it works for you, but you don't look all that different than me. So this is my challenge to you. Is the light shining brightly in you? What do people see when you're the one... Oh, I'm going to step on toes. What do you see... What do people see in you when you're the one that gets the pink slip? What do people see in you when you're the one that gets the diagnosis nobody wants to hear? What do people see in you when the Holy Spirit speaks to you in the grocery store and says, see that person with the limp? I want you to offer to pray for them. And you go, no, I don't think so. What's the Lord seeing in us what are they seeing in us when we're out there claiming to represent Jesus? And if they're not seeing the light, why not? Why aren't they seeing him in us? Because in John 10:10, Jesus said, the thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. Full life. Abundant life. You know what that sounds like to me? Contagious. That when they encounter us, they ought to be walking away scratching their heads going, I don't know what that's about. But man, I'm curious. Can you tell me more? Because you see, they're not going to believe your sermon, but they're dying to hear your story. They're dying to hear your story. What's your testimony? What's God set you free from? What's the Lord doing in your life today? How is your relationship with Jesus and the work of the Holy Spirit in you making a difference that you can declare to them to tell them, here's the experience you have to have? You know how I know they're hungry for experience? Look at the explosion in our culture of books and movies and TV shows connected to the occult. Because you see, Satan's out there dangling the bait saying, I've got an experience for you. This will take you outside of your normal everyday humdrum life. And they're running to it. Why? Because they're not seeing the real in us, they're falling for the counterfeit. They're being sucked in because we created the vacuum. So my challenge to us today is, how's the light want to shine out of you? I can't sit here and tell you, I don't know what the Lord's got planned for you today. Cindy, I don't know how the Lord wants the light to shine out of you today. I just know that he does. Just like he wants it to shine out of me. But the question is, are we willing? Because you know what happened to us? When religion got respectable, when church was respectable, we started clinging to our respectability. See, here's the really challenging thing for me. When I pick this up and read it, especially the Gospels and the book of Acts, I can only come to one conclusion. That's some weird stuff. Read the whole thing. There's weird stuff all the way through it. We got axe heads floating and fire coming down from heaven and 100-year-old women giving birth and people walking on water and raising the dead and healing the sick and telling storms to shut up and sit down. And I mean, there's some weird stuff in here. And it's not just confined to the supernatural and those kind of things. There's weird stuff in here like a guy who could make the whole crowd that came to arrest him fall down on the ground in terror, who lets them get up and arrest him and take him to a cross. There's weird stuff like apostles, unlearned men, untaught men, who stood in front of the ruling council of the day and looked at them and said, we must obey God rather than men, so if you've got to flog us, go ahead. We got stories of people that went to their death singing, worshiping, praising God, thanking God that they were worthy to be beaten for his name. Do you see what I'm talking about? This is why John 1:5 says, the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot extinguish it. It cannot. The only one who can extinguish the darkness is us. How are we doing? How am I doing? How are you doing? Because I'm becoming fully convinced of this. When we commit ourselves to letting the light shine out of the darkness every day through us, they can't help but notice. They can't help but notice. So we need to quit worried about being respectable and being responsible looking. When they come into our midst, they ought to be wondering what's going on with us when the music is going and we're praising God and we're crying out to Him and we're maybe even getting a little footloose. They ought to be wondering what's wrong with us. The kingdom ought to be challenging them. The kingdom ought to be making them go, I don't know what this is, but man, I am really, really drawn to it. Can you tell me more? And see, I've actually been reading an author this week, and it's for my Nazarene ordination class, so I haven't gone off the reservation, okay? But this guy is actually arguing that what we've done is we've taken the gospel, we've cut it in half, we've made one half respectable, and we set aside the other. Because this is the author's argument. The kingdom of God is that we allow the presence and power of the Holy Spirit to flow through us in ways that are visible and tangible to everyone around us. And then when they go, whoa, we say, well, let me tell you about the guy who did that. Let me tell you about Jesus. But instead, what we've done is, let me tell you about Jesus. Well, why do I want to know about Him? Because He can change your life. Really? Where's the evidence? Well, you see the challenge that's before us? How do we proclaim a reality that's not visible in our lives? Now, please don't take this as condemnation or indictment, okay? This is a challenge to all of us. Because I'm challenged by this word. A light that is like a city set on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. That light, if we're allowing it to flow, cannot be hidden. So why is it not so visible in us? And see, this is why I think it's so relevant to those of you that are graduating, because the advantage you have over us is, number one, most of you, and I'm not making a blanket statement, but most of you have been raised in this life-giving church. You've experienced the presence of God. You know God is real. You know the power He has to change. You hear the testimonies. And the advantage that you have is you're not burdened down with all the baggage that a lot of us picked up in church growing up being religious. And because you live in the world and you interact with these people, you know that they're hungry. So this is my challenge to you who are graduating, but it's my challenge to all of us. Who's determining your passion? Who's setting the course of your life? You're making decisions now that are going to affect you for decades to come. Who's deciding those? Who's going to set the path for you? What fire are you going to operate out of? You're going to have a passion one way or the other. What passion is it going to be? But church, I challenge you. I challenge me. What's our passion? Is our passion to come in here for a couple hours on a Sunday morning and maybe do a fusion group during the week and feel like we've accomplished what we need to? I got an amen like that in first service too. That's pretty cool. Are you allowing the light to burn brightly? Are you allowing the wind of the Holy Spirit to fan that to flame so that wherever you are and whatever situation you're faced with, you are dangerous to the kingdom of darkness? I got a long way to go, but I want to be dangerous to the kingdom of darkness. As I heard somebody say one time, I want Satan in the morning to go, oh no, he's awake. And I want that for you. Because they're dying out there. They don't even know what they're missing. They don't know that they're missing anything. They think it's all relative. They do. They don't even have a concept of absolute truth anymore. But when they see the kingdom of God flowing through you, when they see that light burning so brightly and they can't explain it away, now it forces them into a crisis. Wait a minute, I thought there wasn't any absolute truth. I thought there wasn't any God. I thought Christianity didn't make a difference. Well, here's the evidence. What are you going to do with it? I'm going to tell you about this God, and then you're going to have to make a decision. See, that's what Jesus did. Do we understand that was Jesus' purpose? It wasn't just salvation. Jesus came to show us what it looks like when the reign of this God that we just got done singing about, our God reigns, when the reign of God breaks into this world, things change. The kingdom of darkness recoils and gets crushed when the kingdom of our God breaks in. But here's the news, folks. The kingdom only breaks in through you and me. See, as crazy as it may seem to us, Jesus said, all right, Joel, here you go. It's in your hands now. Go carry it out. Not picking on Joel. Joel's a good one to carry the kingdom, okay? Don't take that the wrong way. He's just closest. He put it in our hands. He left it with us. What are we doing with it? And my hope is that those of you that are graduating, those of you that are getting ready to step out in that world, that you're not so encumbered by the things that we learned about God can only move this way, God can only move that way, God doesn't act like that. And that your minds are free and open to be able to say, Holy Spirit, I'm going to check it against the Word, but I want you to move through me in such a way that the enemy cannot quench my light out there. I want you to move through me in such a way that when people are around me, chains are falling off, sin is being convicted, and hearts are being set free. Bodies are being healed, the dead are being raised. People are embracing holiness and turning to God with their whole heart and being filled with a passion they never even knew they could have. That's what the world is looking for. That's what the world needs. How are we doing with that light? It's a tough question to ponder. But we're the carriers of the kingdom. It's been entrusted to us. And are we willing to say to the Lord, you know what? I got a few more miles on me than these graduates do. I've got a few more times around the church block, so I've got a few more conceptions about things that maybe I need to let go of. But Lord, I'm willing for you to do something new in me so the light shines out of me no matter where I am, no matter what situation I'm facing. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot, can never extinguish it. So if the light goes out, it's because we, the light bearers, allowed it to. How's your light? How's your light? Because there are a lot of people out there stumbling around in the darkness that don't even know light exists. Do you realize that? You can't know something exists if you've never experienced it. So we tell them about this light and they're going, nope, never seen it. Don't know what you're talking about. Don't even realize I'm in the dark. I thought this is just how it was, stumbling around, stubbing my toe, stumbling and fumbling. We're the ones that have to introduce them to the light. And the light should be brighter. Okay, how many of you do it? You get up in the morning, house is totally dark, you go in the bathroom, you flip on the light. We all do that for a few seconds. That's what it ought to be like when we're out in the world. Seriously. The light should be shining through us so brightly that they're kind of going, man, what is that? But then once they're awakened to it, they're going to be hungry for it. And if they're hungry for it, they're going to want to know how they can get it. And that's when you get to say, let me tell you about this Jesus I know. Let me tell you about that cross and what he did on that for you. Let me tell you about the Holy Spirit who wants to move into your heart and live in your life right now, today, and he will never, ever leave you. It's on us, people. It's on us. Now, I know this is something you need to ponder. And we are going to take time to honor our graduates because that's what we do here. We do life together. And we are celebrating with them the achievement that they've accomplished. Okay? So I'm going to say a prayer for you. And we're going to move into this time of honoring the graduates. And what I'm going to say is if the Holy Spirit moves on your heart, if he speaks to you about that light and about what he wants to do in you to make you more of a light bearer, to allow that light to burn more brightly, to shine more brightly, then you can come to the altar after we're done with honoring the graduates, and people will come and pray with you if you desire that. Okay? So I would urge you, please, allow the Holy Spirit to do what he wants to do in you today. If he shows you there's something hindering the light, agree with him quickly. Agree with him quickly. Because they desperately need us to be light bearers. Father, I thank you that you are so patient with us. You're so gracious and so good to us. And Father, I repent for my complacency. I repent for the times, Lord, that I would much rather just run to my next comfort zone and hide there. For the times I've argued myself out of knowing that it was your will that I step out and do something in faith that would glorify you. But Lord, I thank you for the promise of your word, right out of Psalm 37:4, that when we delight ourselves in you, and honoring the full meaning of that word delight in the Hebrew, Lord, that we allow ourselves to be made soft and pliable in your hands, then you fill us with your desires for our lives, and you fulfill those desires, and we know that abundant life, that full life that we cannot know any other way. And Father, we repent that we have been living, Lord, at the level of the lowest common denominator. We have lowered our expectations down to the level of our experience instead of insisting that our experience rise up to the level of the expectation you set for us. And we ask your forgiveness for that, Father. Jesus, you came to show us what abundant life looks like, and you said we would do all the things you did and even greater things. Whether that be the signs and wonders or whether that be the evidence of a supernatural love and peace and joy that no one can steal. We acknowledge before you, Lord, that we have not carried the light as you want us to carry the light. That we've allowed things to dim that light. And we ask your forgiveness and we ask, Holy Spirit, that you would move in our hearts and that you would help us to embrace all that you have for us, all that you desire us to be, for your glory, for our good, and for the sake of those that are perishing. Holy Spirit, we invite you in your love and your gentleness. We invite you to show us what needs to change in our lives that we might bear that light faithfully for you. And we do now, Lord, rejoice in your presence over these who have achieved this accomplishment and pray all your blessings over them. We thank you for all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Joel, why don't you come ahead?
Well, today is the day that we are going to honor our senior graduates, and I've had the privilege of walking with them, a lot of them, the last 6 years or so, some not quite so long, but I've gotten to know them and have been blessed by them. And as they carry the very light that Wade's talking about, they've been a blessing to me. But I've had the privilege to know them. Many of you, unfortunately, might not know them personally, or you don't even realize how many we might have here. So we wanted to introduce them to you in a way that it'd be kind of special to them. So we've got a video that shows our graduates from when they began till now and gives you an idea of this incredible group of young people that we're honoring today. So we'll start with that. Guys, if you'd play it, that'd be great.
It's only for a moment you were mine to hold. The plans that heaven has for you will all too soon unfold. So many different prayers I'll pray for all that you might do. But most of all, I want to know you're walking in the truth. And if I never told you, I want you to know that as I watch you grow, I pray that God would fill your heart with dreams, and that faith gives you the courage to dare. You find your wings. May passion be the wind that leads you through your days, and
The line I'm stepping out, so come what may, I give it all, 'cause I'm drawn to you. As long as my heart is beating, where you lead me I will follow. Where you lead me I give my life away. Where you lead me, I will follow forever and a day. Forever and a day. Is my life, and why would I ever turn away? 'Cause deep inside, I know that I cannot rely on anything less than faith. As long as my heart.
Can we congratulate the seniors? Well, today is a day we celebrate what you've accomplished, but we also look forward to what's ahead. You've all come from different backgrounds, different paths to this point, and you've all got unique paths yet ahead of you. And there's something that I want you to hold on to today, because in looking at that path that's ahead, we don't always know what the next step is going to hold for us. We sometimes might have a little bit of doubt of where it's going to lead, but we can take God at his word and cling to his promise that what he started in you, he's going to finish. Philippians 1, verse 3 through 6. I thank my God, and this is how I feel of you guys, as Paul's writing to the Philippians. I thank my God every time I remember you. Always praying with joy for all of you. I thank God for the help that you've given me while I preach the good news. Help you gave from the first day you believed until now. God began doing a good work in you, and I am sure he will continue it until it is finished when Jesus Christ comes again. He will complete it. We've had the privilege of walking these years together, and as badly as some of you wanted to get rid of me, the irony is that we get to continue on together, but still it's kind of a bittersweet day. This season of our lives is coming to an end, and we're starting a new journey. And so here's what I'm going to ask you to do. Seniors, I'm going to ask you to come forward with your parents, or if a grandparent or a support person's with you here today. I'm going to ask you to come up here in a minute. And what I want you to do is, I'm going to do it a little bit different. Usually, you take a candle and you go pray, and then we have you blow out the candle, kind of signifying the end of this season. But in light of what Pastor Wade spoke about today, I almost feel it sacrilegious to blow out the candle. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to have you come forward with your parent or whoever, get a candle, and I want you to think of yourselves as being a carrier of that light. And you can take it somewhere up here around the front, around the altars, and I want you to pray together as a family. I want you to pray about being a carrier of that light. Each of you are going to go on to new things, some to college, some into the workforce, some you're going to live with mom and dad for 15 more years, trying to figure out what you're going to do. Why wouldn't you? I don't know. Oh. But no matter where you go and no matter what you're doing, you're still a carrier of that light. So I want you to take the lights with you wherever you go to pray, and then just keep them lit and just bring them back and put them on the table, okay? We understand it's the end of a season of your life, but it's not the end of being a carrier of the light. So seniors, support people, if you come on up and grab one. And if you're a high school senior here today and you don't have, maybe you would team up with somebody else, but if not, myself will be here. Lisa will be here. If we have some YMT, Pastor Wade, we don't want to leave you out just because if mom or dad couldn't make it or somebody couldn't make it. So come on up now if you would and go ahead and grab that. As you're doing that, I want to pray a blessing over you, and then you can pray together as individuals. Jesus, we thank you for this incredible group of young people. We thank you for the potential that's not only yet to be released, but that already has been. We thank you for lives that have been changed. We thank you for transformation that's occurred. And we thank you for the example that they are in a world that is becoming more and more dark. God, as they're entering into that next season of their lives, may this idea of being a light, not an idea, but a call from God to be a light in the world, may they take it to the next level. May it become ingrained in their heart and in their life. May it burn brighter than it ever has before. Jesus, we thank you for them and ask your richest blessings on them in every area of their lives. Spiritually, of course, emotionally, financially. God, that so many distractions that could block out that light, that they would be removed. So many impurities that they could be removed, and that light would shine on and on and on. That even those that seem so far away would be able to see just how bright it really is. So as they're praying up here as families and friends and loved ones, God, may your Holy Spirit just descend upon them, overwhelm them with your love and your goodness and your purpose for their lives. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As Pastor Wade shared, if any of the rest of you need need to put feet to what he spoke this morning, feel free to do that too. There's room in the front rows here. You can come and sit or kneel there. Or if you just want to come stand behind, not interfering with their prayer times, but stand behind and support a teen in prayer, that's appropriate to do as well. Thank you again for this day. And if you get a chance to bless one of these teens in whatever way, please do so. Please do so. They're incredible young people. Thank you.